Welcome to the lecture on mathematical finance. Today's lecture will focus on arbitrage theory in discrete time. More precisely, I would like to introduce and discuss financial market models, self-financing trading strategies, and the main objective will be to prove the so-called first fundamental theorem of asset prices, which will give you a characterization of arbitrage-free markets. So let us have a closer look at all these objects. To start with, let us fix throughout this chapter the following notations. So I would like to denote by omega fp, as usual, a probability space. And now I would like to consider an index set which has only finitely many values and which end with this capital T. And by capital T, I denote this finite trading horizon. Moreover, I would like to equip our probability space with a filtration, as usual denoted by Ft. And here I would like to assume that F of capital T equals to our sigma algebra F. And you will see later on in most examples, this is trivially satisfied. And here's the definition of a financial market model, and more precisely on a finite financial market model. So a multi-period financial market model here in discrete time is described by an RD plus one valued adapted stochastic process. And this I would like to denote by S bar, consisting of these two components, S naught, which will play a crucial a particular role, which I would like to explain to you in a moment, and this RD valued component S. So you see that's just a vector S naught up to SD. And as usual, I would like to denote the components of this vector by this super index, whereas the sub-index will be reserved for the time index. And this is our process defined on our filtered probability space. And it describes the time evolution of D plus one securities, more precisely of the prices of them. And here I would like to assume the following. First of all, the first component, so this component zero, has a property that it starts at time 0 in 1. Moreover, I would like to assume that this 0 component, so this first component of that vector denoted by this index 0, is strictly positive for all time points. And that's, so to say, the difference between all the other components, which may assume non-negative values, or if they could also assume negative values if you think of a forward contract where you can also go negative. So that's the definition of a financial market model. If you talk about a finite financial market model, then you would like to assume in addition that our sigma algebra F is finitely generated. So what I mean by that? Well, it's nothing else but that you find subsets B1 up to Bn of our underlying space omega, which have the following properties. First of all, these sets Bi are mutually disjoint, meaning that the intersection of Bi with some set Bj is empty for all I and j which are different. The union of all these sets Bi should be equal to omega, and our sigma algebra is simply generated by these sets Bi. And to avoid trivialities later on, I would like to assume that our probability measure P has a property that the probability of each set Bi is positive. And then we talk about a finite financial market model. So this definition is motivated by the fact that our prices for the assets can only take finitely many discrete values. And then you see this pre-image exactly will give rise to such kind of decomposition of our space omega, in order that this random variables, this discrete valued random variables are measurable. And to consider this kind of finite financial market models will only be here a tool which will simplify substantially some proofs which you will see later on. So most of the results I would like to present to you are valid for financial markets model in general, and this additional assumption of finite financial market models is just for convenience of simple proofs. So here's the definition. So this zero component of our financial market model also has a name, namely whenever you have an R-valued process which has a property that it's strictly positive for all times, then you call it a numerator. So here are a couple of interpretations. So this zero component, and I told you that has a particular role, is used for denomination, meaning it allows to compare today's prices with later prices. So you use that component for discounting. And think of that and describing the wealth evolution of your bank account with some interest rate R. And for that, you can assume the following deterministic model, namely that the value ST naught could be described by 1 plus R to the power T. Or if you want, you can also describe it by the following model. ST naught is defined as E to the RT. And you see at time zero, this is both choices are equal to 1. And then for all times, this process is deterministic and strictly positive. But you can also think of more complicated models, namely, for instance, that your interest rate may depend on time. So at each time step, you have a different interest rate. And this could even be a stochastic process. So then you have a non-trivial random process, which has a property that for all time points, it gives rise to a strictly positive value. So we have a numerator. Or you can also think of that as a price of a traded zero coupon bond, where also the prices may fluctuate from time point from one time point to another time point, meaning that this component can be truly random. So the other component of our financial market model, which we denote by S, so that's the components S1 up to SD, describes the price evolution of our risky securities, namely these risk securities which are traded in the market. So having discussed now this particular role of S0, I told you that this is used for discounting purposes. Let us here introduce the discounted price process. So you consider a financial market model, S bar, and then you denote by X bar, consisting of these two components, this process X naught and this process X, and you see that's just a D plus one dimensional vector of a financial market model. And these components are defined in the following way. Xi of t is simply equal to Si of t divided by S naught of t. And you see, since we assume that S naught of t is strictly positive, this operation is well defined. And you define that discounted process then for all i's and all t's. And here's a trivial observation. Since you do that for all i's, meaning also you do that for the zeros component, you see if you divide S0 of t by S0 of t, you simply get 1, meaning that discounted process has a property that the zero component is constant equal to 1. So, having introduced this discounted process, let us now come to trading strategies. So what should we understand about a trading strategy? And that's nothing else but an RLD plus one valued predictable stochastic process. And I would like to denote that by H bar. And if I want to get use of that, I write that as the process H naught and this process H, whereas H naught is R valued and H is again RD valued. You see that these components of this process. And it's defined in our filtered probability space. So predictable refers here to that filtration with which we equipped our favorite probability space. And here we would like to assume that the component at time point zero equals to the component at time point one. Remember that predictability means that the process at time point t is ft measurable for all t larger or equal to one. So meaning we have no conditions imposed on the zeros component. And for simplifying later on the notation, I define simply H naught to be equal to H1, because then we can simply write down formulas without distinguishing cases. So here are a couple of remarks. So first of all, for any time point E, so the component hi of t, so what's the interpretation of that? So that's simply the following. That's the amount of shares of the security I which you held between the time interval t minus 1 and t in your portfolio. So what does it mean? So you bought a number of shares from the security mi. And this number is denoted by hi of t. And the price you have to pay for that thing is simply the product of the number of shares to buy times the price of the shares at that time point t minus 1. And then you keep that in your portfolio until time t. And if you then sell it, that's the amount of money you get out of that. And so you see why we have assumed here predictability of that process, because that process only depends on the information of our prices at time point t minus 1. Meaning you see these kind of prices, and based on these prices you make the decision how you set up your portfolio. So meaning how many shares of that security SI you keep in your portfolio. And note that this HI, so the component of that trading strategy at time point T, might also be negative, meaning that you sell this share even if you don't have it. And this means simply that you have to rebuy it at the next time point or at the terminal time point. So having that discussed, let us now see what is the consequence. So how can we have a trading strategy such that we can rearrange at every time point our portfolio without taking any additional money into account? Meaning this strategy should have the property that without having additional money at hand, we can simply reshuffle the amount of shares in our portfolio. And you see what the condition should be. So that's the amount of money we invested. That's the amount of money we get out. So meaning, if I want to invest in the next time period, so this is amount of money I got out, so I should invest at most that amount of money. So that's the payoff at time point t, and by that dot I simply denote the scalar product between this d plus 1 dimensional vector h bar t and this d plus 1 dimensional vector s bar t. And you see that amount of money we got out at time point t, we can invest for the next period, meaning for the period from time point t up to time point t plus 1. And we should not invest more, so meaning that difference should be equal to 0. And then we have simply rearranged our portfolio without taking any additional money at hand. Okay, so and that observation here give rise to the following definition. Trading strategy on our financial market S bar is called self-financing when exactly that relation which we observed on the last slide holds true, namely that H bar T scalar product with S bar T equals H bar T plus 1 scalar product with S bar T. And this should hold true for all time points from 1 to capital T minus 1. So let us now have a closer look at all these self-financing trading strategies. Can we find different representations for them? And that's the first statement of this lemma 2.1. So we give ourselves d plus 1 dimensional financial market, here denoted by S bar, having these two components, S naught and S, so where this component S naught stands for our numerator, which we used as for discounting purposes, and this S denotes simply the vector, this d-dimensional vector of our share of this securities we are interested in. And by H bar, I denote a trading strategy, also consisting of this component H naught and this component H. And then it holds true that this trading strategy is self-financing, if and only if the following holds true, namely that the scalar product between H bar T and S bar T equals to the scalar product between H naught T between H naught and S naught, and so H bar naught and S bar naught, plus the discrete stochastic integral between the process H bar and the process S bar. So recall that big dot stands for the discrete stochastic integral, evaluated at time point T. So and this relation should hold true for all time points T in our index set I. So let us have a look at these both directions. So first we would like to prove that if H bar is self-financing, then this equation holds true for all time points T. So let us start simply with that right-hand side, and let us massage all the appearing terms in such a way that that expression comes out using that H bar is self-financing. So here it is. So I consider the scalar product between this component of the trading strategy at time point zero and the our financial market at time point zero plus this discrete stochastic integral. So in the first step, let me write out what is the definition of that discrete stochastic integral. So that was nothing else but the sum n from 1 up to t of h bar n scalar product with a difference of s bar n minus s bar n minus 1. So what I would like to do now is simply I would like to multiply that bracket out. So meaning I get the components, so the scalar product h bar n times s bar n minus h bar n times s bar n minus 1. But now I can take advantage of the fact that h bar is self-financing, meaning that h bar n minus 1 No, that h bar n times s bar n minus 1 equals h bar n minus 1 times s bar n minus 1. So if you plug in that thing, you get the following telescopic sum over here. Namely, the sum n from 1 to t of the scalar product between h bar n and s bar n minus the scalar product between h bar n minus 1 times s bar n minus 1. And you see from this telescopic sum, only the first and the last term survives. The rest cancels out each other. So, and the last term is simply this h bar t scalar product with s bar t. And the first term is simply minus h bar naught times s bar naught, but this cancels exactly that term over here. So in that way, we have proven exactly what we want to prove, namely that this expression over here, namely this sum between the h bar naught times s bar naught plus this discrete stochastic integral at time point t equals to the scalar product h bar t times s bar t. So let us now have a look at the opposite direction. So how does the proof works in that situation? So let's fix a little t in that interval or in this index set 0 up to capital T minus 1. And I would like to consider the scalar product between h bar t plus 1 and s bar t. So what I would like to do in the first step is simply I add and subtract the following term, namely I add that term h bar t plus 1 as scalar product with s bar t plus 1, and here you see I subtract that, and then I take that term into account, which we started with, and I simply factor out that term h bar t plus 1. So in that way I obtain here that difference between the financial market model at time point t plus 1 minus the financial market model at time t. So what I should do next? Well, we have that backward direction, so we have that formula at hand. So let us plug in that formula at time point t plus 1, at exactly that stage. So what do we obtain? Here, so we simply obtain the scalar product between h bar naught and s bar naught, plus this discrete stochastic integral between h bar and s bar at time point t plus 1. And from that we have to subtract that term over here, which we factor out, namely the scalar product between h bar t plus 1 and the difference between our financial market model at time point t plus 1 minus the financial market model at time t. So now remember the definition of that discrete stochastic integral. So this was simply the sum n from 1 to t plus 1 of h bar n scalar product with that difference of the financial market model. And you see, this term over here is exactly the last summand in that finite sum over here, which goes, since we have here t plus 1, up to t plus 1. So it cancels out. What we are left with is simply this initial value, namely the scalar product between the trading strategy at time point 0 and the financial market at time point 0, plus the discrete stochastic integral at time point t. And then we can use again what we know, namely that this is equal to h bar t dot s bar t. And this was exactly what we wanted to prove, because this tells you immediately that our trading strategy by definition is self-financing. Let us now introduce the so-called discounted value and gain process. So what is that? So consider a discounted price process. So we have our financial market S bar, then we can define our discounted price process X bar simply by dividing each component by S0t, since the zeroth component of our financial market model is numerary. And then the discounted value process, which I would like to denote by VH bar, so it depends on our trading strategy. So, and this is a process with values in R, simply defined as the following, namely the value of VH bar T, and so this discounted value process at time point T is nothing else but the scalar product between H bar T and X bar T. And on the other hand, the discounted gain process, which I denote by GH, notice here it's GH, not GH bar, and you will see in a moment why, is also a one-dimensional process, and it's defined as the discrete stochastic integral between this component H of our trading strategy H bar and this component X of our discounted price process evaluated at time point T. So what's here the observation? Why it's only H, not why don't we see the zeros component? And now remember the property of that discounted price process, namely that the zero component is constant equal to 1 over time. So in this definition of a discrete stochastic integral, we see differences between the price or the discounted price process at time point n and the discounted price process at time point n minus 1. And you see, if you have one component which is equal to 1 for all time, this simply gives rise to 0, because 1 minus 1 is simply 0. That's why you end up in this discrete stochastic integral, which is vector valued, and then you take the scalar product, first of all, on the side of the process, with a vector where the zeros, so the first component of that vector, which I denote by zero, is simply zero all the time. That's why you don't see the zeros component of your trading strategy. So let us have now a look what we can say about the relation between self-financing trading strategies and this discounted value and gain process. So that's the statement of the following lemma. So I consider a financial market S bar, and I consider a trading strategy H bar, and then the following are equivalent. First of all, H bar is self-financing. Second, it holds true that H bar T scalar product with X bar T equals to H bar T plus 1 scalar product with X bar T for all time times T in the interval on this index set 0 up to capital T minus 1. And the last assertion is that the value process at time point T equals to the discounted value at time point naught plus the value of the discounted gain process at time t. So, and the proof is rather simple, so that A and B are equivalent simply due to the fact that we divide or that we have that this zero component as naught t is strictly positive for all time points. So, and you see the difference between the definition of a self-financing trading strategy and what we stated here in this point B is simply that we divided both sides by S naught T. And this gives you immediately the assertion that A and B are equivalent. You see it here. That's the definition of self-financing of a trading strategy. And if you divide both sides by S naught T, you end up with the scalar products where you have, instead of S bar T, the value of the discount price process X bar T. So let us come to the second bit, namely I would like to show that B is equivalent to C. And that's similar to what we have seen already in the first lemma. So let us first show that B implies C. And here observe that our zeros component of our discounted price process is constant to 1. And then, so what we want to show? We want to show that given this relation between the trading strategy and our discounted price process, it holds true that the discounted value at time point t can be written as the discounted value at time point 0 plus the gain at time point t. So we start again with the right hand side. So let us have a look at the discounted value at time point 0 plus the gain at time point t. So this can be written as, by definition, as the scalar product between h bar naught and x bar naught plus this discrete stochastic integral n from 1 up to t of h bar n scalar product with, so here's a typo, it should not be h bar, it shouldn't be h of n scalar product with xn minus 1. And now let us take into account the fact that the zeros component is constant equal to 1. So then I can also rewrite that discrete stochastic integral or these summons over here as h bar n scalar product with x bar n minus x bar n minus 1. And then I take into account the assumption B, namely that I can rewrite that thing as the scalar product between h bar n and x bar n minus the scalar product of h bar n minus 1 and x bar n minus 1. And now you see again we end up with a telescopic sum. Only the first and the last term of this telescopic sum will survive. The first term is cancelled with that term and only the last term remains, and that's exactly by definition the value as the discounted value at time point t. And this is what we wanted to prove. Okay, so this was the first direction. So the second direction that C implies B is similar to the previous proof. So we start with the scalar product between the trading strategy at time point t plus 1 and the discounted price process at time point t. Then we add and subtract the value of the discounted of this trading strategy at time point t plus 1 and this discounted price process at time point t plus 1 and subtract that value. Then we use that we can rewrite by C that term over here simply as the value, the discounted value at time point 0 plus the gain at time point t plus 1. And you see that what we have over here is simply the last term. So by subtracting from the gain at time point t plus 1, that term over here, we end up with the gain at time point t. And so to say, that sum over here by using the definition C again gives rise to the value at time point t, which is by definition nothing else but the scalar product between the trading strategy at time point t and the discounted value and the discounted price process at time point c. And in that way we proved that lemma. So let us now come to an interesting lemma, namely how we can construct self-financing trading strategies. And the assertion of the lemma is the following. You start with a financial market model, S bar, and you give yourself a process, an RD value process H, which should be predictable. And then the statement is the following. For every value V naught, there exists a predictable process H naught, which is one dimensional, so which has values in R, such that this H bar which we define simply as this vector of this process H naught and this process H, and these are these components, is a self-financing trading strategy with discounted value at time point zero given by this value V zero. So how we should prove that kind of lemma? So here's the first observation. So if you have a trading strategy, which is nothing else but an RD plus one valued predictable process, and you assume that the trading strategy is self-financing, then we have seen by the previous lemma then that it holds true that the scalar product between the trading strategy at time point T and this discounted price process at time point T equals the value of the, or the scalar product of this trading strategy at time point T plus one and the discounted price process at time point T. And now what I would like to do is I would like to rewrite these two scalar products. So I'll simply write them out in terms of what we know about the zeros component and the price process at the discounted price process at the zeros component and the scalar product of the remaining components. And since x zero t is constant equal to one, you end up with the following statement, namely that the difference between h naught t plus one and h naught t equals to minus the scalar product of the difference of this component h t plus one minus h t and this discounted price process x t. So these are a scalar product between two r-dimensional vectors, and here you, so this simply gives then a real value, and this equals to that difference over here. So that observation we would like to use to construct our process H naught in such a way that the resulting process H bar is a self-financing trading strategy. And the construction goes as follows. First of all, we define H naught equal to H1. And then we define the zeros component, so H naught naught, so at time point zero, simply by the following difference, namely by V naught, which should be some value in R, minus the scalar product between H naught and the discounted price process at time point zero. And recursively, we define H naught T plus one simply by H naught T minus this difference h t plus 1 minus h t scalar product with x t. So what are the observations? First of all, so this process h naught is predictable. So why is that the case? You see, the time point t plus 1, O is measurable with respect to f t. And that holds true for any t from 0 to capital T minus 1, because that term only depends on the process at previous times. And since this process X is adapted, this simply gives rise to the fact that that component here is F T measurable. So hence, also that vector H bar is, which is an RD valued process, is predictable. And in addition, by that construction and the observation we made over here, because we constructed this component in such a way that it satisfies that relation for any time point T, you see, simply bring that thing on the other side, then by definition, it's exactly that side, and we observe that this is equivalent to that statement over here, which gives us by the previous lemma that H bar is indeed a self-financing trading strategy. So it remains to compute the discounted value at time point zero. So the discounted value at time point zero is by definition nothing else but that the scalar product between the self-financing trading strategy at time point zero and the discounted price process at time point zero. Let us write down the two components, namely it's the product between h naught 0 and this value of the discounted price process, namely x naught 0, and x naught 0 is equal to 1, plus the scalar product between h naught and x naught. And you see, by definition, h naught 0 was simply equal to v naught minus the scalar product between h naught and x naught. And you see, by plugging in that term over here for that object, you see that these two scalar products cancel out each other, and you end up simply with the value v naught. And in that way, this lemma is proved. So after we have introduced this discounted value process, let us now come to a definition of an arbitrage opportunity. So here it is. So give yourself a financial market model, which I denote here by S bar, which should be an D plus one dimensional stochastic process. And you give yourself a self-financing trading strategy, which I denote by H bar. Then this trading strategy is called an arbitrage opportunity if the following holds true, namely that the discounted value process satisfies the following properties. First of all, the value of the discounted value process at time point 0 should be less than or equal to 0. At the terminal time point capital T, its value should be larger or equal to 0 p almost surely. And moreover, the probability that the discounted value process at time point capital T assumes a value which is strictly positive has positive probability. Okay, so here's a clear and trivial remark. You can rephrase this condition on the arbitrage opportunity also in terms of this price process S bar, right? Remember that the difference between S bar and X bar is simply that you divide it by the first component of your financial market, which is the numerator. And since you simply divide it by something which is non-negative, you see, or which is positive, you see immediately that this condition over here, namely V naught of H bar, which is nothing else but the scalar product between H bar and X bar naught, is equivalent to the scalar product between H bar naught and S bar naught, being less than or equal to 0. The same holds true at capital time point T, and also the probability of that event has then it's equivalently a positive value. Okay, so here's, so to say, one important theorem, namely it gives you an explanation how a multi-period financial market model, which admits an arbitrage theory, somehow relates to a one-period financial market model. So in the statement is the following. So consider a multi-period financial market model, meaning that capital T is larger or equal to 2. And then it holds true that this financial market model, which I denote here by S bar, admits an arbitrage opportunity if and only if we find a time point, which I would like to denote by little t star, in this set 1 up to capital T, and I find an RD valued F t star minus 1 measurable random variable, which I denote by eta, such that the following holds true. First of all, the scalar product between eta and this increment x and t star minus x and t star minus 1 is non-negative p almost surely, and the probability that the event that the scalar product between eta and the increments of this discounted price process at time points t star and t star minus 1 is a positive, has positive probability. So let us first the direction that starting from a multi-period financial market model which admits its arbitrage opportunity implies the existence of such a T star and an eta with that property. So what do we know? So we know when we consider a financial market model S bar which admits an arbitrage opportunity that there exists self-financing trading strategy H bar with which has the property that its discounted value at time point zero is non-positive. The discounted value at the capital time point T is non-negative per almost surely, and that the probability of the event that the discounted value at capital time t is positive has positive probability. So this we know by definition of an arbitrage opportunity. So now define t star as a minimum of all time points t in our index set such that the discounted value at this time point t is non-negative p almost surely, and the probability of the event that the discounted value at time point t is larger to zero has positive probability. So by definition, we know that t star should be less than or equal to t. Why? Nein. You see, by that definition of an arbitrage opportunity, definitely at time point capital t, that condition over here is fulfilled. So let us now have a look, what do we know at time point t star minus 1? So then two things may happen. Either the probability that the discounted value at that time point t star minus 1 has a negative value with positive probability, that's case 1, or case 2 is that the discounted value process at time point t star minus 1 is equal to 0 p almost surely. So these two things can happen. So let us have first of all a look at that first case. And let us construct now that random variable eta which should have these two properties. So I define eta simply as h of t star times the indicator function that the discounted value at time point t star minus one is smaller than zero. And then let us observe what we know about that random variable. First of all, since h is a predictable process, we know that this value over, so that random variable over here, is f t star minus 1 measurable. We also know that the discounted value process at time point t star minus 1 is f t star minus 1 measurable, meaning that product over here is simply an f t star minus 1 measurable random variable. Okay, so that's the first condition for eta is fulfilled. Moreover, we immediately see that this random variable eta is RD valued. So what remains is to compute simply the scalar product between eta and the increments of the discounted price process at time point t star and t star minus 1. So let's do that. So let's consider that scalar product and let us plug in the definition of eta. So then we see that this gives rise to the following, namely the indicator function that the discounted discounted value is negative at time point t star minus 1. And here's again a typo, that's not h bar, simply h. And that's this component h t star of our trading strategy, scalar product with this increments, which is simply that bit over here. Now let us observe the following. Since this discounted price process has the property that the zeroth component is constant equal to 1 for all time points, we can also write the scalar product between h t star and these increments as the scalar product between h bar t star and the increments x bar t minus x bar t minus 1. So here's a typo in that way. So doing that and multiplying out that bracket gives rise to the following statement, namely that this scalar product over here is equal to the indicator function that's discounted value process at time point t star minus 1 is negative times the increment between the discounted value at time point t star minus the discounted value at time point t star minus 1. So what do we know? By definition of t star, we know that as the discounted value at that time point t star is larger equal to 0. So meaning that thing is larger equal to 0. And then you see by that indicator function, we also know that minus the discounted value at time point t star minus 1 is larger equal to 0. So by that we immediately see that the scalar product between eta and the increments of our discounted price process x t star and x t star minus 1 is larger or equal to 0 p almost surely. And moreover, we also know that the probability of the scalar product being larger or equal to 0 can be bounded from below by the probability of the event that minus the indicator function that's the discounted value process at time point t star minus 1 is negative times the discounted value process at time point t star minus 1 takes a value which is larger or equal to 0. And this random variable larger than 0 is equal to the probability of the event that the discounted value process at time point t star minus 1 is negative. And by definition, we know that that probability, so this was exactly the assumption in our case 1, has a value which is positive. And by that, we exactly have checked that this constructed random variable satisfies these two conditions. So let us now come to the second case. The second case is now the following, namely that the discounted value process at time point t star minus 1 is equal to 0 p almost surely. So in that situation, define this random variable eta in the following way, namely that's simply equal to h of t star. And since the process h is a predictable process, we know that eta is f t star minus 1 measurable. And now again, let us compute the scalar product. And we see by plugging in the definition of eta, and here again is a typo, this should be either this should be not a bar, or you should put bar over here. Then this thing is equal to using again this property that the zeroth component of our discounted price process is constant equal to 1, and that's where we can plug in and write here also the bar. It gives then rise to the following difference of the following two scalar products, namely the scalar product between the trading strategy at time point t star and the discounted price process at time point t star, and the same, namely that this value of the trading strategy at time point t star minus 1 and the discounted price process at time point t star. So you see, that's nothing else by definition as the value, the discounted value of our game process at time point t star, and using here the definition of a self-financing trading strategy, I can rewrite that scalar product over here also as a scalar product between the trading strategy at time point t star minus 1 and the discounted price process at time point t star minus 1, which is equal to the discounted value at time point t star minus 1. And by assumption, we know that that object over here is equal to zero, Pierre almost surely. Hence, we end up with that value over here. But by construction of t star, let's go back, we know that that value at time point t star is larger or equal to zero. And we also know that the probability of this event being strictly positive has a positive probability. Hence, that random variable eta, which we defined over here, has exactly these two desired properties. So let us now come to the opposite direction, namely, assuming that we have this time point e star and this random variable eta, which satisfies these two properties, that we can conclude from that that this multi-period financial market model admits an arbitrage opportunity, meaning we have to construct a self-financing trading strategy which should have the property that the corresponding discounted value process satisfies these three properties. So let us have a look how we do that. So we define HT simply by eta times the indicator function that t is equal to t star. So what we should do first, we should come up with a self-financing trading strategy. But here the idea is simply to use lemma 2.3, which allows us to construct process H naught in such a way that the resulting predictable process H bar is a self-financing trading strategy. So how we do that? Well, we use that lemma 2.3 and we construct that H bar exactly as given there with V naught equal to zero, meaning that the discounted value process at time point zero is equal to zero. So, and then we have by lemma 2.2c that the value of the discounted value process at time point capital T is equal to the value of the discounted value process at time point zero, which is equal to zero by our choice of V naught in the lemma 2.3 plus this discounted gain process. But the discounted gain process is nothing else but this discrete stochastic integral between h and x. Let us write down this definition of this discrete stochastic integral. So it's nothing else but the sum n from 1 to capital T of h n times a scalar product with the increment of the discounted price process xn and xn minus 1. And now let us plug in the definition of ht, namely, which is equal to eta times the indicator function that t is equal to t star. So you see, almost all terms in that sum is zero, except for the term when n is equal to t star. And then that at that point in time, we have then eta of t star times the increments of this process xt star minus xt star minus 1, and ht star is equal to eta. And now, from the properties of this random variable eta, namely that we know that this scalar product is larger or equal to 0, p almost surely, and that the probability of the event that this random variable takes a value which is strictly positive, has positive probability, it follows immediately that our training strategy H bar, which we constructed by means of lemma 2.3, is an arbitrage opportunity. So before coming to a close, let us present to you two corollaries of that theorem. So the first corollary is the following, namely that a multi-period financial market model S-bar is arbitrage-free if and only if for each time point S in the interval 1 up to capital T, the one period financial market model, namely this market model, this process S naught T S T, where T is in the index set S minus 1 and S, defined in our filtered probability space omega F F S minus 1 F S P, is arbitrage free. So meaning we can, if we know the arbitrage freeness of a financial market model in one period, and we know that for each of these one period models, then we immediately know that also our multi-period financial market model is arbitrage free. And that's a crucial observation. So here's a proof, and it's simply by contradiction. So let us first prove the first direction. So assume that there exists a time point S in our index set 1 up to capital C, and we assume that there exists a self-financing trading strategy H bar, such that the following holds true, namely such that H bar is a arbitrage opportunity, meaning that the discounted value at time point S minus 1 is less than or equal to 0. The discounted value at time point S is larger or equal to 0, P almost surely, and that the probability of the event that the discounted value at time point S is strictly positive has a positive probability. So that's somehow exactly the contrary of that event over here, that all for all time point S, the one period financial market models are arbitrage free. So what should we do? So then, since we know that we have here an arbitrage opportunity, we know that there exists an eta defined here by H of S, which is an RD valued random variable defined on our filtered probability space omega FFTP. That is FS minus 1 measurable, and it satisfies the following two conditions, namely the scalar product between eta and XS minus XS minus 1, which is nothing else but the increment of our discounted value process at time point S and S minus 1. And you see by definition, this value is larger or equal to 0. This value over here by definition is less than or equal to 0, meaning with a minus sign in front, this difference over here is larger and equal to 0, P almost surely. We also know by that same reasoning that the probability of the event that the scalar product takes a value which is strictly positive has positive probability. Hence, we can apply the previous theorem, which tells us that our multi-period financial market model in that situation admits an arbitrage opportunity, which is in contradiction to our assumption that this multi-period financial market model is arbitrage free. So let us come to the opposite direction. So let us now assume that our multi-period financial market model admits an arbitrage opportunity. Again, we can apply the previous theorem, which tells us that there exists an T star and an RD valued random variable eta, which is FT star minus 1 measurable, such that the scalar product between eta and this increments XT star minus XT star minus 1 is larger or equal to 0, P almost surely, and that the probability of this scalar product taking a value which is strictly positive has positive probability. Again, we can use lemma 2.3 to construct a predictable process h naught t in the interval now t star minus 1 and t star, such that the resulting process h bar, which is simply given by h naught of t and eta times the indicator functions at t is equal to t star for t in this interval t on this index at t star minus 1 and t star, is a self-financing trading strategy with initial value v of t star minus 1 equal to 0. So we apply that lemma 2.3 exactly with little v equal to 0. So what does it mean? This simply means that this constructed H star is an arbitrage opportunity for our one-period financial market model, and that's in contradiction to our assumption. Hence, the contrary is true, and in that way, that corollary is proven. Here's another corollary, which tells you, if you have a financial market model, then the following are equivalent. That's namely that this financial market model admits an arbitrage opportunity, and the statement that there exists a self-financing trading strategy H bar, such that the discounted value process V of H satisfies the following properties, namely that VH bar at time point 0 is less than or equal to 0, and that the discounted value process at time point t is larger equal to 0 p almost surely for all time point t from 1 up to capital T, and that's the probability that the value process at time point capital T takes a value which is strictly positive with positive probability. So you see the difference between the definition of an arbitrage opportunity and that statement is that this thing should hold true for all time points, little t, in this index set 1 up to capital T, whereas in the definition of an arbitrage opportunity, this was only asked for the terminal time point capital T. And I leave the proof of that corollary for you as an exercise. So before coming to a close, here's an example how we can check if a financial market model is arbitrage free. And in that situation, I simply consider a two-period model, so capital T is equal to 2. I consider a financial market model which only consists of our bank account and our of our one security. And for simplicity, I would like to assume that the price of our bank account, so the zeros component, is constant equal to 1. And the component S1 of t, so that price process, I would like to model as a binary splitting model. And remember, the binary splitting model was defined in the following way. You give yourself, in this situation, since capital T is equal to 2, two random variables u1 and u2, which takes values in plus minus 1, and you define the following functions. F1 of u is simply equal to 6 times the indicator function that u is equal to 1 plus 3 times the indicator function that u is equal to minus 1, meaning that function over here takes only two values, namely 6 and 3, depending on whether u is little u is equal to 1 or little u is equal to minus 1. And the second function is a little bit more complicated, namely it takes the value 8 or 5, depending on whether u is equal to 1 or u is equal to minus 1, in case that little x is equal to 6. Or it takes the values 4 and 2, depending on whether u is equal to 1 or u is equal to minus 1, in case that x is equal to 3. So Once you have given this function, then you define this process S1 simply by the following. S1 naught is equal to 4, so you start deterministically. S11 is simply f of u1, and S12 is equal to f2, so that's f1, that's f2 of S11, u2. So you see here that's somehow an illustration of all possibilities which can come out. So you start with value 4. So if u1 is equal to 1, then the S11 is equal to 6, whereas if u1 is equal to minus 1, S11 is equal to 3. And then you see, now it depends on which value you have and what happens next. So suppose S11 is equal to 6, then you can split up into the value 8 or 5, depending on the value of a u2. Namely, if u2 takes the value plus 1, then you jump up to 8. Whereas if u2 takes the value minus 1, then you jump down to 5. And likewise in the other situation. So let us check if that model is arbitrage-free or not. So, and I claim it is arbitrage-free, and it's for the following reason. So for t equal to 1, let us compute the scalar product between eta and x11 minus x10. So plug in what we know. So this is nothing else but eta times S11 minus S10. And now you see what happens. So it's simply 6 minus 4 times eta in case x11, which is nothing else but S11, is equal to 6. Or it's equal to minus eta in case that x11 is equal to 3. And now you see you're asked for that sum over here takes a value larger equal to 0. But you see the only possibility you have that eta is equal to 0. Why? Now suppose eta takes a value which is strictly positive. Then you see in that case you get something positive, but in that case you get something negative. So you don't achieve that scalar product for all omega. So p almost surely is positive. And a similar computation also shows you in that at time point t that occurs. Namely, if you consider now this scalar product between eta and x12 minus x11, then you see you have these two differences depending on what was the value at x11. And you see again, you have here a difference between 2 eta and minus eta, or eta and minus eta. And this can only be larger or equal to 0 in case eta is equal to 0. But when eta is constant equal to 0, and that's the only possibility to achieve that this scalar product is p almost surely non-negative, you cannot satisfy the second condition, namely that this scalar product assumes a strictly positive value with positive probability. And then this way you see that in that model we cannot construct an arbitrage opportunity.